We are looking at the Element by Darkglass Electronics. So this just came out July 8th, I believe. I am about a week behind the curve here. It's a headphone amp. It is an IR loader, cabsim. It is not a pedal. I know this is the pedal studio. I would not call this a pedal. There are no actual buttons on the front face of it. So it doesn't fall in the pedal category for me. It's more of a device. It can be used in conjunction with the pedal board and of course with your instrument and backing tracks and all these things that we shall get into shortly. Full disclaimer, Darkglass did send me this device for free. They are not, however, paying me to make this video. So with that being said, let's check out what this thing does and perhaps slightly controversially what it doesn't do. But first, let's start the show. So confession time, right up front, I'm not a massive fan of cabsim IR, and I know that is one of the big features of the Element. So you may be asking yourself, so why on earth are you making a video about this if you're not even really going to feature one of the main functions of the unit? Well, one of the advantages of being a week or more behind the curve in terms of the release of this device is that there have been plenty of videos made already that feature the cabsim function on this. It's a really nice, sleek, touch sensitive quote unquote button, I guess you got to call it, in the front, but it's like a button, not a button. Has a little LED that shows up. There are 5 cabsim locations. It comes loaded with 3 bass cabs and 2 guitar cabs, and you can download the Darkglass software. You can attach it to your PC, your device via USB-C, and download many other IRs and cabsims. So you're not stuck with the 5 that it comes with. You can swap them in and out using that software. Side note on that, as of the making of this video, there's still no iOS software. So that was a bit of a bummer. I'm an iPhone guy. There is an Android version, there is a Windows version, and there is an OS X for your Mac desktop or laptop. But as of yet, no iOS version. It's normally the other way around. It's normally the Android people saying, when are you going to make an Android version? For a change, it's the Apple guy here saying, when are you going to make an iOS version? I don't doubt that that is in the future, but as of the making of this video, that's one thing that's not around. And in reference to some of the videos and demos that are already available on YouTube of this device, I watched as many as I could. I wanted to find out as much about this device as I could before I made a video on it. There are some that claim this is what will solve your problems in terms of jamming with your friends. That is kind of not true. There is a workaround, and we are going to get to that later in the video, but in terms of the larger feature sets and inputs on this device, it's actually not for jamming with your friends. It's not for having a guitar player and being a bass player like I am and then working on that with 2 sets of headphones kind of in silence to the rest of the world. It's not that at all. There's in fact a diagram in the manual of the Element that says in a very specific way, please don't attempt to plug 2 instruments into this because there's actually a risk of an electric shock. So it's not that. And then along with that, I'm not so sure what the second headphone output is for. I know that this started off as a headphone amp on the Darkglass booth at the NAMM show earlier this year in 2020. And apparently the feedback was great. It had, you know, a selector on the front and a volume knob, and 2 people could plug in and listen to 1 person playing in a demo situation. And for that, I think this is probably, you know, perfectly designed for that. That's what it was designed for, as far as I can tell, for the NAMM show in the first place. Now it's been purposed into a device with more features. But at the same time, I'm really not sure what the second headphone output does when you can't plug at least to the same quality level 2 instruments into the device and then jam together and blend them. I know that in my career of over 25 years, I've never been in that position where I've had to play something for someone and I've needed to listen on headphones and they've needed to listen on headphones and I've needed to plug an instrument into a device to facilitate that. I could see how that may work in a teaching situation, a silent teaching situation, where a teacher would play something for a student and the student would listen, but then to reverse that role, surely you'd have to unplug the teacher's instrument and replug the student's instrument, or you would use some sort of splitter to go 2/4 inches into one, so two instruments. It's just still a little bit of a head scratcher as to what that function is outside of literally being at the NAMM show and having two friends there and one's playing the guitar and the other one's listening. Like, that just hasn't happened ever in my entire career as far as I remember. So let's get to the controls on the front. There are two faders, two touch sensitive faders on the front of the device, one for each headphone out, and then a blend. So it's Bluetooth enabled. This is one of the things I really like about it. It's not all doom and gloom here. I actually love some of the features on this device, and Bluetooth and being able to play backing tracks via Bluetooth with this device, fantastic feature. And as a practice device, I've sat here at my desk over the past couple of days and jammed along to some things in my phone with just the bass, and it's been great. I'm really not a fan of playing bass on headphones. I've always had a phobia with that in the studio on recording sessions. I've always wanted to be as close to the amp as possible and really feel that air moving. Now, you might ask yourself, so the cabsim thing should be a massive bonus feature for you, giving you more of that feeling of being with the amp and not being with the headphones. Not so true. It's a digital experience of that. It's not actually the feeling of the air moving or the ground moving or those vibrations. So that's also why I'm not a massive fan of the cabsim. But having said that, I do like the sound of the headphone amp in this device. It sounded good in these not particularly fancy studio headphones. These are $35. You know, AKGs, they are not top of the line at all. They do the job, and my bass sounded like my bass. It was a true representation of my natural sound. So for that, I cannot ask for anything more in terms of a headphone amp. So what starts to get slightly tricky for me when it comes to using this device for what it's being marketed as and the feature set that it claims to have is that there are a couple of things. Not to say that these A can't be changed, rectified, added in the future. I'm really just speaking as the device exists right now in my hands on my desk. What I do is create a lot of content, not just for YouTube like this, but for my own teaching site at Janek's Bass Studio. I write a lot of books. I'm about to use a play along from the Bass Player's Guide to Pentatonics. And I create a lot of this kind of content where I talk and I play and I analyze things in real time, and at the same time the camera is running just like it is here. So the downside of working with a backing track in my door in Logic here and not having this device is that if I were to have that, it would be in its own channel. I would have to move it around if I didn't want to completely stop the recording and stop everything and just film that segment. I would have to move it around and start the recording there. And when I wanted to stop the play along to talk over the top of it, I would have to mute that channel, or I would have to just talk over the top of it and then edit that down in volume of post-production. In this case, I can play a backing track just like this. And as soon as I want to say, okay, let's analyze these chords or stop or pause, there it is. It's totally stopped. It's totally paused, but everything's still running. The video's still running. The computer's still running. I don't have to go and edit that in post-production and chop a bunch of things together. It's all happening in real time. So a headphone amp with Bluetooth where I'm running my backing track from going into the door, big plus. The big downside about this is, and we're so close to this being an unbelievably useful feature, is that if I use the XLR output on the Element, it only records my bass. If I take the XLR out into my door, it will not record the backing track. It will only record the bass signal. So I'm having to use a workaround with an 1/8-inch cable, this guy right here, coming out of the second headphone output and going into a channel on my interface and recording that, which is less than optimal because then I have kind of two signals going into one. It'd be nice to split those out. And I think that could possibly be achieved maybe with the USB C port, I'm not sure. I also, side note here, I have heard that the Element is going to have the option to be an interface. So that could be a great recording option for your computer or laptop if you're on the road or you're traveling or being mobile or something like that. You want to record in your hotel room. This has USB-C. If they add that feature, which I have heard from several sources they're going to, that would be a big win. Perhaps with that USB-C option being an interface for your door, perhaps that could then split out the signals. You could get two channels going into your system. I'm not sure. Right now, it's a workaround. So that's, like I said, where it gets a little bit tricky, like a massive win feature that we're so close to, but not quite there, that I've found with the unit is it needs a workaround. It's not something that is kind of standard or particularly obvious when you first sit down with it. But it does work. The workaround does work. I can play that backing track. I can adjust the overall level of it by using that headphone 2 volume level. I'll tell you what I'm not doing right now is having my headphones actually plugged in to the Element itself. My headphones are plugged into my interface just because I'm monitoring my voice. And this is kind of my little, you know, temporary YouTube recording setup in this thing. I'm not using any amp, any DI, nothing like that at all. So that's what's going on. That's the current setup. And with the backing track playing in the background here, I can use the blend to bring more of it in, and I can use the headphone number 2 as kind of the master fader for that mix. That's a little low for me, so I want to bring in a little more bass. Maybe even a little more bass. So this is one of the examples, like I said, in Bass Player's Guide to Pentatonics, that's in the palm muting section, hence I'm palm muting. But a great example of that would be, you know, in the middle of recording an instructional video or giving a lesson, something like that, would be able to have the backing track running and be able to then explain, okay, here I am, I'm palm muting. Now let's try the same groove, but using fingers, using regular finger style, restart the backing track and go to the fingers. So that's kind of workaround number 1 to really get to what I think could bring massive value to a unit like this, especially for what I do in this space of creating content, playing a lot of bass, analyzing it, discussing it, really giving tutorials and lessons in that sense. Super nice to have that flexibility to start and stop from an external source rather than have to line everything up and do a bunch of post-production. Much better solution to run it through a Bluetooth-enabled device like this. But it's still a workaround. It's not like a fully fledged feature that's, you know, being marketed for that, and I think that's maybe a little bit of an oversight and something that could probably be developed, I'm guessing, fairly easily and would bring massive extra value to the rest of the things that are on the unit. Now, when I see a product like this, I immediately try and slot it into all the situations that I might possibly use it in. The first one that sprung to mind is that, you know, I'm a touring musician for some of my life, for part of the year. I do spend a lot of time sitting in hotel rooms. I have been known to go and do gigs at the last minute where I have to learn a lot of music at the very last minute and am quite often cramming the night before or the day of a show. I remember not that long ago being in Italy, in Milan, starting a tour with Mike Stern and Randy Brecker and Steve Smith. And really having to brush up on some of the music the night before the show, and I'm sitting there on my bed with the laptop playing the audio through the little speakers, and I'm playing my bass, you know, not plugged in. I didn't have a headphone amp with me at the time. That's the kind of thing, kind of on the move and mobile, that I think this should be really valuable for. But you still need to plug this into the wall. This doesn't have batteries. I know that Darkglass cite the environment for not using batteries in their products, and I believe I have another couple of their ridiculously great pedals sitting here. More videos on these two bad boys coming soon, but I believe most of, if not all, of their pedals don't use batteries. This might be the one thing where I would say, man, it would be really nice if you made an exception. Again, there could be a possible workaround where you had an external battery and a little, you know, a little adapter that looks something like this plugged into a 9-volt battery. That could work. It's still not convenient. It's still not compact. And having to plug this into a wall socket sort of diminishes the value for me, especially at the price point and the fact that there are a bunch of other products on the market way cheaper that do offer that feature. I do get it that that's a great reason not to put a battery in a product. The environment, I do agree with that, ethically speaking. But in terms of the amount of stuff we have that is battery powered, the phone, I mean, just about everything, I'm not sure how much of a dent this is making in the environment, but it definitely is diminishing the value of it in terms of how I perceive it being used as a musician, as a touring musician, as someone who needs that functionality when I'm on the road. I need to be able to do that in an airport, in a quiet corner, perhaps even on the plane if there's no one sitting next to me and I have space. I mean, really, the amount of times I've had to work on music in weird places where I need, you know, absolute silence, which this provides, of course, but it also has to be battery operated as well. Otherwise, it just won't work. I'm guessing that there's an argument that this is more of an IR, of a cab sim, and it's going to sit at the end of a signal chain in a pedal board, and most pedal boards have pedal power on them, so no real need for a battery. But kind of the last thing I want to do when I get to the hotel room is like unpack my pedal board and plug it in and then take out a power spot from another pedal, because this isn't going to be on there the whole time, I wouldn't imagine. Plug it into this, reroute it. It's just not that functional in terms of the portability of it. And going back to the two headphone outputs, again, as soon as I saw this, I was like, oh wow, two headphone inputs, gotta be two instrument inputs, right? Because this is the ideal thing where you want to work with a bandmate, especially in that situation I just mentioned about being on tour with someone like Mike Stern. If Mike calls me to the room and says, hey, I wanna work on this new song, all we need is two pairs of headphones and both plug in and we can actually work on it. With a second input, with a second legit input, I think this could, again, bring huge value. It's one of those things where it's so close to being like a massive tool, but it's sort of falling a little short in a couple of areas. There is, like I said, a workaround. I haven't actually tried this yet, but I am guessing you could take an 8-inch cable, plug it in to the aux in, take the other end of it and stick a 1/4-inch adapter on it, put that in your instrument and use that as a second instrument input. Disclaimer, I'm not gonna take any responsibility as I haven't tried this yet. I'm not saying do this, I'm saying it might be possible. I'm not gonna take any responsibility for people blowing up their gear by trying that. Maybe I'll try it and post it on Instagram or something, see if it works. This also brings up a bit of a question about, okay, why do we really need the fader, the blend in the middle? Why not have, you know, first of all, just two instrument inputs so we don't have to use that workaround? And then if you wanna mix between the backing track and the instruments, I mean, the iPhone has a volume control, right? So that's your blend pretty much right there. And then you just have two separate volume controls for the two people enjoying either jamming to the backing track or playing with each other. And then this could be purposed or maybe even multi-purposed to something else. Maybe that could be some sort of control or switch or, you know, splitter for the USB-C interface element to get two tracks out instead of one. I don't know. It just begs the question as to why you would actually need a blend then, and the fact that most devices that you might be playing a backing track on have a volume and are therefore their kind of their own blend control. But again, we've got the real estate of 2 1/4-inch ins. I'd love to know if it was possible to make these multifunction, to have a selector switch or something, and give this thing like a massive boost in functionality and value. Another video I saw about this kind of mentioned like, yeah, you know, if I'm too lazy to turn on my speakers at my door to practice, blah, 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 I'll use this and plug some headphones in, put it on the end of the board. First of all, I think if you're too lazy to switch your speakers on, literally just do this, then maybe music is not the thing for you. Yeah, just a thought. And again, like I said before, to someone that is not a massive fan of cabsim and IR, that's not the greatest solution to that problem. And if I'm home, if I have the option to turn speakers on, I'm going to turn them on. I'm you know, if it's not about practicing like late night or in a quiet place, or you want to give your neighbors or your spouse or your family a break from whatever it is you're doing, if it's not about that, if it's really just about being lazy, whatever that's about, I would go with the speaker every time. But this thing looks great. It is engineered, I would say, to perfect. It's a very pleasing object to hold in my hands. I'm not sure it's $249 worth of pleasing to hold in my hand. It's got one of these nice little toggle switches. What is that? Minus 13 or minus 12 or something like that. My eyesight's so bad I can't see it, but it's a little pad. It's a little dip in volume in case your input signal is too hot. And I did use it as a DI. Sounds great. It represented the natural sound of my bass. I went into my system. That all worked very well. But at the end of the day, I think it comes down to what your budget is, what you are looking for in terms of functionality. And what I hope is that this gets like some major upgrades. Hopefully the things I mentioned can be done mainly with firmware. And this could be pure user error. Let me hear your feedback about this thing. If you have tried it, if you've looked at it, if you've checked out the features, let me hear your feedback about what you think about all the features it has, the ones it doesn't, the ones it almost has, perhaps where it could be improved. I think it's inches away from being a really amazing utility tool, a practice tool, a learning tool, a teaching tool, potentially a recording tool if the whole USB-C interface thing happens, like I have heard rumors of. But right now, in terms of the price point and what else is on the market that does a very similar thing, I don't think I can honestly say I would have spent $249 on it, despite the fact that I love the way it feels, the way it looks, and the way it sounds as a headphone amp when I'm practicing. For me, it has checks in the win column, it has checks in the loss column, and I don't doubt that this is not the final iteration of the Element. I'm sure there will be updates on it. I purposely made this video before talking to Darkglass about any of these things, about any of these concerns. What I didn't want to do was make a video that didn't capture my honest reaction to the product. I'm not being paid to make these videos. Yes, Darkglass sent me this for free, as they did a couple of other things. Like I said, the Alpha Omega and the Microtubes X Ultra that I'm gonna make videos on. Two pedals I know obviously much more about, and they have way more function musically, which is generally what I'm doing on this channel. So I am going to reach out to Darkglass, mention a few of these things that I've talked about to you in this video, and see what they say. I will report back on that, and hopefully that helps me give you an honest opinion about this device. As always, leave your comments below. This could be one of the more controversial picks in terms of the pedal studio and videos I've made, because it's not something I'm like 100% raving about. I'm being a little critical in places here, but I think that's important. I think that's important for the integrity of my videos and for my honesty with you, the audience, and also for the discussion that I hope will follow with Darkglass in terms of what might be done with this and what might change for the better in terms of kind of upgrading the feature sets and maybe adding a couple of things and really bringing the value kind of through the roof. Because as a foundation, I think the potential is hugely there, and perhaps it's not quite where it could be just yet. So thank you, as always, for spending some of your very precious time with me watching this episode of the Pedal Studio. Like I said, Alpha Omega Ultra and Microtubes X Ultra videos coming soon, amongst others. I just got so many cool things coming up that I'm really excited about making videos on, and we'll see you guys on the next episode.